Right, we begin with today's class, and today is also going to be a problem discussion class, as in we'll be discussing all the problems which we can possibly solve on your lens formula and your refraction from a curved surface. So I have a list of questions which I wanted to discuss, so I'll be doing that. But apart from that, if you guys have any doubts, please feel free to let me know over the chat, right? We'll be discussing those as well.
Right, the question which I wanted to discuss was your question 9.5. Your question 9.5 over here. Pretty good question. So please have a look at that question.
A small bulb is placed. I hope it's visible to you guys, right? Yeah. A small bulb is placed at the bottom of a tank containing water to a depth of 80 centimeters. So what's the area of the surface of water through which light from the bulb can emerge out? The refractive index of water is given as 1.33, which is equal to 4.3. Right? So let me draw the diagram. Right. So let's look at how to solve this question number 9.5. So we didn't discuss any question on total internal reflection. So I'm giving, this is a question based on total internal reflection. Right. So you have a bulb, you have your source of light, that is your bulb. Your bulb is located at the bottom and it's located at a depth of 80 centimeters. Oh. We need to find out over what area from the water will the light from the bulb emerge? Over what possible areas? As in, what's the total area from which light from this bulb can emerge? Right, is the question asked over here. Now, the first thing which should be striking your mind is, why is it that it's only possible for light to come out from some area? Why is light not coming out from other areas? As in, why is not light not going there? Or why is it really coming out in between the dotted lines that I've shown over here? Right? So, the first thing is, where is the light traveling from? First of all, your light, your bulb is first of all located inside water. So, your light rays from the bulb are traveling from water to air. Your light rays are traveling from water to air. And you know that whenever light travels from a denser to a rarer medium, that is, in this case, it's traveling from water to air. Water being a denser medium, there is a possibility of total internal reflection happening. Once again, there's a possibility. It's not necessary that total internal reflection will happen always when light travels from denser to rarer. There is a possibility of total internal reflection to happen, right? And when will you say total internal reflection will definitely happen? You will say the total internal reflection will definitely happen when the angle of incidence is greater than a critical angle. Remember, what was your critical angle? The critical angle was the angle of incidence at which your angle of refraction becomes greater than 90 degrees. Sorry, becomes equal to 90 degrees. Your critical angle was the angle of incidence for which your refracted ray, for which the angle of refraction becomes 90 degrees. So if your angle of incidence is greater than critical angle, that means that a refracted ray is not possible, which means that you will not have any refracted ray, only reflection will happen. That was your concept of total internal reflection, right? So let's apply this concept over here. So once again, your light rays from the bulb, there will be many possible light rays from the bulb. You will also have these light rays, you will also have these light rays. But let me go from light rays at the center. Let me consider this light ray first. Light ray which is going exactly to your center. Now, what angle will this light ray make with the normal? The angle which this light ray, the dotted line which you've drawn over here, the angle which it makes with the normal, that's your angle of incidence. So your angle of incidence for this light ray will be zero for a point which is lying directly above it, right? And now, let me consider light rays which are away from the center. So the first thing you should observe over here is, as I'm moving away from the center, because I'm considering light rays away from the center, is your angle of incidence increasing or is it decreasing? As I'm moving away from the center, your angle of incidence is increasing. Your angle of incidence over here is zero. But as I'm now taking a ray which is away from the center, you find that now you have an angle of incidence. This will be your angle of incidence over here. So your angle of incidence is increasing now as you're moving away from the center. So that's one more point. That's one point you need to observe over here. Now let's say that at a particular point, that is at your point X over here, at a particular, for this light ray which is incident on the surface at X, let's say that this angle of incidence is critical angle. Let's say at this point, your angle of incidence is critical angle right now. I'm assuming that this light ray is hitting your surface at a point X, such that your angle of incidence over there is a critical angle. So what's your critical angle once again? Your critical angle is the angle of incidence for which the angle of refraction will be 90 degrees. So let me find out what the critical angle will be first of all. Let me find out what this value of theta c is. That is a critical angle. So what's the formula we'll be applying? What's the logic once again? The angle of incidence for which angle of refraction becomes 90 degrees. That is when a ray becomes this way. When a ray becomes refracted, it becomes this way. Right? So we'll write your Snell's law for this case. So what is your Snell's law equation for that case? The refractive index of water, that is 4/3, into sine of angle of incidence, which is sine of theta c, should be equal to refractive index of the other medium, so that would be 1, into sine 90, This is the logic you'll always be using to find a critical angle. The critical angle is the angle of incidence for which refracted ray becomes 90 degrees, right? So what do you get your sine theta c to be equal? This is 1, this is also 1. So you get your sine theta c value, that is your sine of the critical angle to be equal to 3 by 4. Or you say your critical angle is equal to sine inverse of 3 by 4. Whatever that angle is. Right? So critical angle is in this case, we have calculated what the critical angle is, and that would be sine inverse of 3 by 4. Right? Now, if I'm considering light rays to the right of this, if I'm considering this light ray, which is lying to the right of this region, it's lying in between a point X, and let me name this as point Z. That is the point which is lying directly above the path. With your angle of incidence, for all these light rays lying in between these two points, for all the light rays of the bulb which is lying in between these two points, will your angle of incidence be less than critical angle or greater than critical angle? Again, as I mentioned, as you're going away from the center, your critical angle increases. So when you're considering all these rays, your angle of incidence for all those angles will be less than this angle. Your angle of incidence for these rays will be lesser as you're going more and more towards the center. Right? So that means all the angle of incidence for all these rays now, that will be less than critical angle, which means that those rays can undergo a refraction, which means that those rays can come out of the surface. So this ray can come out of the surface. This ray can now come out of water. Even this ray can now come out of water. Similarly, like point X, you'll have a point pi symmetrically, where your I will be equal to theta c. Right? Imagine that this is a cone now. This has to be a cone over here. The diagram has to be a cone, but I can't draw a cone on a board. So you'll have to imagine the 3D surface, right? Anyway, if you have looked at point X, your angle of incidence was critical angle. Now, before point X, that is point line, that is for the rays lying between X and Z, or for the rays lying between Y and Z. For these two rays, that is for rays 1 and 2, your angle of incidence will be less than critical angle. So these rays can undergo refraction. So these rays can come out of the medium. So all the light rays which are now there in between these two points, that can come out of the medium. But once again, remember, this is not a 2D diagram, this is a 3D diagram. So all the rays lying in between that circle, that can come out. But now if I consider this ray, ray 3 and ray 4, this will be your angle of incidence for them. And what is your angle of incidence for ray 3 and ray 4? So this is your ray 3 and this is your ray 4. That is beyond the points X and Y. At the points X and Y, your angle of incidence was critical angle, right? So for your ray 3 and 4, the angle of incidence will be greater than critical angle, which means refraction is not possible for them, which means that these rays will not come out of the medium. These rays will lie inside the medium as they'll get reflected and then come back to the same medium. Right? So where does the light from the bulb? Come out? So in between what region is it possible for your light rays from the bulb to come out? Your light rays from the bulb will come out in between the circular region between X and Y. Your light rays from the bulb will only come out in between this region. Is that clear? And now we'll now try to find out. So now I know where are these rays coming from. Your rays will only come. So all the rays in between the shaded region, that can come out. So the surface area from which these rays will be coming out is the surface of the circle. It's the area of the circle. Now I need to find out what the area of the circle is. So let me draw a better diagram. So hopefully you're able to understand why are rays coming out only from that region. Why are rays not coming out beyond that region? So that is your concept of total internal reflection, because for those rays, that is for your rays 3 and 4, or for rays lying beyond X and Y in the diagram I have drawn. So now going back to the diagram, I know that your rays will come out from that bulb only between X and Y. So any ray beyond this, that will not come out. Any light ray beyond this, it will not come out. And I also know what this length is equal to. This length is given as 80 centimeters. And I know what this angle is. I know what is the angle of incidence of the extreme ray. That is the final ray which can come out of the surface of water. And that will be a critical angle. We have found out what the critical angle is. The critical angle was sine inverse of 3 by 4. Right? So now the question asked is, from what area can this light rays come out? So the area from which your light rays can be come out is the area of the circle. So I need to find out what the radius will be equal to. And I have a right angle triangle over here. So this angle is theta c. This angle will also be equal to theta c. Right? And now I need to relate your height to radius. I know what the height is. If I relate it to the radius, I'll get what the radius will be equal to. So I need what tan theta c will be equal to. Right? The sine theta c was equal to 3 by 4. So what will tan theta c be equal to? Tan theta c will be equal to 3 by root 7. Your tan theta c will be equal to 3 by root 7. And that is equal to opposite divided by adjacent. So that will be equal to your radius divided by 80 centimeters. That will be equal to radius divided by 80 centimeters. So what will be the radius of the circle through which all these light rays will be coming out? The radius of the circle through which all these light rays will be coming out will be equal to 3 by root 7 into 80 centimeters. The radius of the circle through which all these light rays will be coming out is 3 by root 7 into 80 centimeters. So what's the area through which they will be coming through? That will be a pi r squared. So that will be equal to pi into 9 by 7 into 6400 centimeters squared. I'll leave the calculation to you. But this will be your answer for the solution. I mean, this will be the answer for the question. That is, through what area can these light rays emerge from the bulb? So let me summarize what we have done over here. Once again, the question was, you have a bulb lying at the bottom of a tank. The depth of the tank is given as 80 centimeters. The question asked was, through what area, what will be the area through which these light rays will be coming out? The light rays from the bulb can be coming out. So first of all, how did we conclude that your light rays will be coming out only between x and y? Because at x and y, your angle of incidence, we have kept the condition that your angle of incidence should be critical angle. So at these points, refraction can happen. And even before these points, your angle of incidence will be less than critical angle, which means refraction is possible, which means these light rays can come out. The light rays lying in between x and y. But now if I go beyond x and y, now your light rays will not come out because your angle of incidence will be greater than critical angle. So this was a concept based on your total internal reflection. And how do you solve it later? By using your trigonometry later. After you found out what the critical angle is, you're now using your trigonometry over here to find out what the radius of that circle will be equal to. And then from that, we're finding out what the area will be equal to. So your area will be equal to pi into 9 by 7 into 6400 centimeters squared, right? So this was a question from your NCERT textbook. I hope you guys are doing that as well. You have an NCERT textbook with you, right? The problems on NCERT are pretty good. The level of problems are pretty decent. You should be solving these kind of problems as well. Anyways, we'll be doing some of them right now. So this was one question which I wanted to touch upon. Now let me give you another question.
9.8, I think you guys can do it. Let me discuss another one. That is 9.19. We'll now discuss question number 9.19. This is also a good question. All of these are questions from your NCERT textbook. If you don't have any other textbook, you always have your NCERT textbook to solve problems from, right?
That's the first thing you should be solving problems from. Anyway, so now let's solve this question. That is your question number 9.19. In question number 9.19,
image of a small electric bulb fixed on this wall of a room is to be obtained on the opposite wall, which is 3 meters away, by means of a large convex lens. So what's the maximum possible focal length of the lens required for that purpose? So you want to create an image of a small electric bulb, and the image should be created on a wall which is 3 meters away from the bulb, okay, which is 3 meters away from the other wall. You need to find out what's the maximum possible focal length of the lens required for that purpose.
Right, so let me draw a diagram for that.
You have a bulb maybe over here. Your opposite wall now acts as a screen. And the distance between them is given as 3 meters. So this is your wall, which is acting like a screen. So let's say you have a large convex lens in between them, right? So this is your object. We want the image somewhere to be located over here. We want the image to be formed on the wall. So what's the maximum possible focal length you can have?
So that the image is formed on the wall? This is the question.
This is a good question. You will actually see that there are many similar questions to this. So hopefully by doing this one question, you'll be able to identify the similar questions to this. Right?
So the condition over here, I think, is clear. You need to make sure that you need to select the largest possible focal length in such a way such that your image is formed on the wall. Right?
Okay. So let me assume that this lens is placed at a distance of x from the object. That is your bulb.
So what is the distance of the image? Where should the image be formed? I want the image to be formed from the formed on the screen, definitely over here. So I know that this distance has to be equal to 3 minus x. Right?
So one thing which you should be careful with over here is, now we'll be using your lens formula 1 by v minus 1 by u square 1 by f. Please remember your x and 3 minus x are values, as in they are the distances. So x and 3 minus x over here are definitely positive values. X and 3 minus x are over here definitely positive values. So please don't get confused with sign convention when you're substituting. Remember that x and 3 minus x are positive over here because they are distances, right? Anyways, so I want the image to be formed on the screen. So let me assume your lens is placed at a distance of x from the bulb, that is from your object. So now what's your lens formula? 1 by v minus 1 by u is equal to 1 by f.
So let me substitute that in this equation. So that'll be 1 by the distance is 3 minus x. The image should be formed at a distance of 3 minus x from the lens. Is the image formed on the positive side or is it formed on the negative side according to sign convention? Your rays are incident from the bulb to the lens. So rays are traveling towards right. So the right side of this lens is positive, left side of the lens is negative, which implies the image is formed on the right side itself, that is a positive side. So your distance is 3 minus x, and I should consider the positive value of the distance. So 1 by plus 3 minus x minus 1 by, again, this is the positive value and this is the distance of the object from the lens. This is the distance of the object from the lens. So x here is a positive value according to me, right? So then what will I substitute this in this formula? Your object is lying on the negative side. So this will be 1 by minus x over here. And this will be equal to 1 by f, right? So now solving this equation, writing down, further simplifying this equation, what do we get? Your LCM for this will be, so this will become plus 1 by x. So this will become x plus 3 minus x into f, taking f to the other side, will be equal to x into 3 minus x. Right? Your x plus 3 minus x into f will be equal to x into 3 minus x. Right? So what do I get from this equation? I get, so x and x gets cancelled. We get 3f is equal to 3x minus x squared. Or we get x squared minus 3x plus 3f is equal to 0. We get x squared minus 3x plus 3f is equal to 0. So by writing an equation for x, we end up with a quadratic equation. We end up with a quadratic equation. And this is the quadratic equation which we have, right? And now if we find out what the roots of this quadratic equation is, should that root be a possible value or should it be an imaginary value? If you, you've read quadratic equations, right? So you know that there are imaginary roots and real roots possible for this. Now, your x value must be real. Your x value must be possible over here. It should not be imaginary because I want a possible value of x. I want this image to be formed for an actual value of x over here. So my x value must be possible, which in other words means I want a real value of x, right? And if your value of x must be real, what should the discriminant of this quadratic equation be? It should be greater than or equal to 0, right? So can I say that the discriminant of this quadratic equation for real values of x, I want the situation to be possible, which means that my discriminant of this quadratic equation should be greater than 0. So then only I'll get real values of x. And what is the discriminant of this quadratic equation? The discriminant of this quadratic equation is b squared minus 4ac. That will be 3 squared minus 4. A value is 1. C value is 3f. F is a constant over here, right? So this is your discriminant over here. And what should this discriminant value be? This should be greater than or equal to 0, right? So what do we end up with from this equation? We get 9 minus 12f is greater than 0 or equal to 0. We get 9 minus 12f should be greater than or equal to 0. Or we get 12f should be less than or equal to 9. This goes to the other side, right? So 12f should be less than or equal to 9. So f should be less than or equal to 3 by 4 meters. So that should, that implies your focal length should be less than or equal to 0.75 meters. So what does this imply? If your focal length is less than or equal to 0.75 meters, then the discriminant of this quadratic equation will be greater than or equal to 0. Then you'll get real values of x, or that is your possible values of x, which can satisfy the given condition. That is, an image must be formed 3 meters away from, right? So that means what's the maximum possible of focal length possible? The maximum possible value of focal length over here will be equal to 0.75 meters. Right? So this is a good question. As in, you have to understand what the meaning of this quadratic equation is and what condition should we take to make sure that you know, an image is formed on the screen over there, right? So this is one question which you need to understand. Now you'll have many questions of this kind. So let me solve one more question of this kind to make sure that you have understood it to a certain extent, right? So hopefully you guys have understood this. So let me move on to the next question. Yeah, the next question we'll be solving is the next one, 9.20. The 9.20 is a similar question. It's a similar thing. But now you need to analyze that equation properly. What are the, whatever equation you get from solving this, you need to analyze it properly now. So a screen is placed 90 centimeters from an object. The image of the object on the screen is formed by a convex lens at two different locations, which is separated by 20 centimeters. So determine the focal length of the lens.
Okay. So a screen is placed 90 centimeters from an object. So let's say this is an object, 90 centimeters from it, a screen is placed. And now you see that
this object will form an image on the screen for two different values of, for two different locations, right? It will form an image for two different locations, which are separated by 20 centimeters, which are separated by 20 centimeters. So these are the two locations. Let this be location one, let this be location two, right? So when your lens is placed at these two locations, you find out that an image is formed, and the distance between these two locations is given as 20 centimeters. So you need to find out the focal length of the lens. The focal length of the lens is what we need to find out over here. So this is your diagram of the scenario, right? Now the convex lens is at two different locations. The image of the object is formed on the screen itself. Your screen is not shifted. Your screen is at the same position. But when you place a convex lens at two different locations, that's the meaning of this question, right? I think that's the English meaning of it as well. Right? I think that's the idea you should take over here as well. Right? It's formed by convex lens at two on the screen. The image of the object on the screen is formed by a convex lens at two different locations. So this convex lens is at two different locations. I can see where, why you might have the doubt. But that is the question over here. Your convex lens is at two different locations over here. Right? Not the image. Your image is always formed on the screen over here. Right? Fine. Anyway, so this was the question. Your convex lens is now at two different locations, and at two different locations, it will form the image on the screen. And these are separated by a distance of 20 centimeters. I mean, the location one and the location two, where you place your convex lens to get an image, that is separated by 20 centimeters over here. So you need to find out what is the focal length of the lens compass. We need to find out what the focal length of the lens compass is, right? So let me not be concerned with both the locations. Let me first try to find out one location. And you will see that that will give me the answer for both the locations, right? So let me assume that when I place this lens at a distance of x from the object, similar to your previous question, let me assume that when I place this lens at a distance of x from the object, the image is formed on the screen. The image is formed on the screen. So what should be the distance of the image from the lens? The distance of the image should be equal to 90 minus x, right? And here it's in centimeters. Previously that was in meters. So that means you'll get the answer in centimeters. It's one thing you should be careful. Right. So once again, the lens I'm assuming is placed at a distance of x. So the image will be formed 90 minus x distance from the lens. And now substituting this in your lens formula, that is 1 by v minus 1 by u is equal to 1 by f. What do we get now? We get 1 by 90 minus x. Once again, 90 minus x, you should take the positive value because your image is formed on the positive side. Minus 1 by minus x. X is just the distance. I'm taking x as a positive value over here. So by using sign convention, that should become minus x over here now. If this was 20 centimeters, you have written it as minus 20, right? So doing the same thing over there. So 1 by 90 minus x minus 1 by minus x is equal to 1 by f will be your equation, right? And now simplifying this equation, what do you get? So that will become plus 1 by x. So we get x plus 90 minus x on the numerator. Then bringing f to the other side, that will be equal into f is equal to 90 minus x into x. So this is the equation we'll be getting, and we'll once again end up with the quadratic equation. Now you should make sense of what this quadratic equation means. That's what we are trying to find out over here. Anyways, what's the quadratic equation we get? So let me continue that over here. We get 90f is equal to 90x minus x squared, or we get x squared minus 90x plus 90f will be equal to 0, right? So this is the quadratic equation you get, right? And now, if I solve the values of x for this, what does that mean? If I solve this quadratic equation for the values of x, that tells me the values of x for which the image will be formed on the screen, because that is the condition we have taken. The image is 90 minus x, the object distance is x. So if I solve for the roots of this quadratic equation, that will tell me the possible values of x where the lens can be placed such that the image is formed on the screen. And how many possible values are you getting over there? What are the roots of a quadratic equation? You always have two roots of the quadratic equation, right? So that means that there are two possible values of x over here, which can give me this particular scenario, which can give me the answer for this particular case. There are two particular values of x. There are two possible values of x, which will give me a solution for this problem, right? So let me assume that roots to be x1 and x2. Let me assume x1 and x2 are the roots of this quadratic equation. But now I know the next condition as well. I know an extra condition. And that is, I know what x2 minus x1 should be equal to. What is your x2 minus x1? I know at one location, so x1, this value will be x1. That is one possible root of the quadratic equation. That is one possible value of x, which will give me the solution. The other location will be the other possible value of x, which will give me the same scenario, which will form an image on the screen. So that is an x2 over here. And I know what's the distance between these two locations of the lenses. The distance between these two locations of the lenses is 20 centimeters. That was the condition given in the question. So that implies your x2 minus x1 should be equal to 20 centimeters. Right? And do you have a formula for difference of two roots of the equation? You don't have a formula for difference of two roots of the equation. But you have a formula for product of the roots and sum of the roots. So we'll be using that. You get what x2 minus x1 will be equal to. So what is x2 plus x1? x2 plus x1 should be equal to minus b by a. So x2 plus x1. So x1 and x2 are the roots over here, right? So x2 plus x1 should be equal to 90. Correct? And x1 into x2, that is your product of the roots. That will be equal to c by a. So that will also be equal to 90. So what is x2 minus x1 from? So now, substituting this in this condition over here. So what do we get x2 minus x1 to be equal to? Using that condition. No, I made a mistake, sorry. Your x2 plus x1 should be equal to 90. Should be equal to 90. That's a coefficient, minus b by a. Your x1 into x2 should be equal to 90f. Where f is a constant over here, I'm sorry. Your x1 into x2 should be equal to 90f over here. Right? So then what should x2 minus x1 be equal to? Can I write x2 minus x1 as under root of x2 plus x1 whole squared minus 4x1 x2? Right? So that means the 20 centimeters should be equal to under root of 90 squared minus 4 into 90s minus 4 into 90s, right? So what do you get from the squaring both sides? We get 400 will be equal to 8100 minus 360s, which implies I get my f value now to be equal to what is it? It'll be equal to 7700 divided by 360 centimeters. And whatever that answer is, you can further simplify it. So your focal length should be equal to 770 by 36 centimeters, right? So this is one kind of question. I hope I've not made any calculations, have I? X is equal to 90, x plus 90f is equal to 0. Yeah. So x1 and x2 are the roots. X2 minus x1 should be equal to 20 centimeters. So x2 plus x1 will be equal to 90. X1, x2 will be equal to 90s. Yeah. And now solving this quadratic equation, this is the roots you end up with, right? Or this is the value of f which is possible for that given condition. That is your x2 minus x1 should be equal to 20 centimeters. So these are some kind of questions. Again, these kind of questions actually are pretty common. These kind of questions have come before in JEE as well, right? So you need to understand that in these kind of questions will always lead to a quadratic equation. And it's very important for you to understand what the meaning of, what meaning can you get from that quadratic equation over there, right? So this would be a solution for this question. Your answer for this question may be equal to 770 divided by 36 centimeters. So that's approximately, I think, 21 or 22 centimeters, right? One model probably which I need to discuss, which I'll probably write it down as a formula rather than discussing it, because it's pretty simple now. You should be able to understand what I'm going to discuss right now. When you discuss for a mirror, we discuss the case of when an object is moving, what will be the velocity of the image, right? So let me take a similar scenario over here as well. So let's say you have an object lying in front of a lens, and the object is moving at the velocity v0. So you need to find out what the velocity of the image will be equal to. So now can you tell me how will you get a relation between velocity of object and velocity of image? How do you get a relation between velocity of object and velocity of image in your mirror, for a mirror case, by differentiating the equation? So we'll do something similar over here as well. So let me derive that formula quickly. So once again, the question is, if you have an object in front of a lens moving at the velocity v0, what will be the velocity of the image? And the case we are considering right now is when the object is moving along the principal axis, right? So what will you do for this case? You'll differentiate both equations. You'll differentiate both sides. So d by dt of 1 by v minus 1 by u should be called d by dt of 1 by f. Your v changes with time. Your image distance changes with time. Your object distance also changes with time. But the focal length of the lens will remain constant with time. That will not change with time over here. So what will this equation become? This will become minus 1 by v squared into dv by dt plus 1 by u squared into du by dt will be equal to 0, right? So what is dv by dt? Dv by dt will be your rate of change of image distance. So that will be velocity of image, right? So what is dv by dt equal to? You get dv by dt to be equal to v squared by u squared into du by dt. That is v squared by u squared into du by dt. So what is dv by dt over here? That's the rate of change of image distance. That will be velocity of the image. So velocity of the image will be equal to image distance squared into object distance squared into velocity of object. Dv by dt is the velocity of the object over here. Right? And your sign convention will be the same as whatever sign convention you applied over here. So in this case, then this object is moving in this manner. Right? Is it moving in the direction of incident ray or opposite direction of incident ray? It is moving in the direction of incident ray. So you take that value as positive. Right? So your sign convention rules will be the same for how you'll substitute it over here. So here you'll substitute the value of V naught to be a positive value because it's moving towards the lens. If it was moving away from the lens, it's moving in a direction opposite to the direction of incident ray. So in that case, you'll substitute a V naught value to be negative of that velocity value. Right? So